Tent or Audio presents Mink River by Brian Doyle. Narrated by David Drummond. The only music I can compose is that of little things. Giacomo Puccini. The past has not passed away, but is eternally preserved somewhere or other and continues to be real and really influential. Everybody and everything is so closely interwoven that separation is only approximate. Pavel Florensky. Animals, as they pass through the landscape, leave their tracks behind. Stories are the tracks we leave. Salman Rushdie. Part 1. 1. A town, not big, not small, in the hills in Oregon, on the coast, bounded by four waters, one muscular river, two shy little creeks, one ocean. End of May. The first salmon berries are just ripe. Not an especially stunning town-wise. There are no ancient stone houses perched at impossible angles over eye-popping vistas with little old ladies in black shawls selling goat cheese in the piazza while you hear Puccini faintly in the background, sung by a stunning raven-haired teenage girl who doesn't yet know the power and poetry of her voice, not to mention her everything else. No houses crying out to be the cover of a magazine that no one actually reads anyway, and the magazine ends up in the bathroom and then is cut to ribbons for a fourth-grade collage project that uses a jar of rubber cement that was in the drawer by the back stairs by the old shoebox, and the jar of rubber cement is so old that you wonder secretly if it fermented or a mouse died in it or what. No buildings on the national register of hysterical places, though there are some old houses, the oldest of which finally collapses on page 141. No cheating ahead to watch it slump like ice cream at noon, please. But there are some odd, sweet corners here, and friendly houses and sheds and barns, and a school and churches and shops, and certain rhythmic angles in the town, where a road and a building and a line of trees intersect to make a sort of symmetrical, geometric, architectural, textual, physical music in the right light. The kind of juxtaposition of things that painters like to paint for inchoate, inarticulate, unconscious reasons they can't explain. And the light itself, well, there's a certain certainness of light here, the way it shafts itself through and around things confidently, exuberantly, densely, substantively. It has something to do with the nearby ocean, maybe, or the rain, which falls 8 months a year, or the sheer jungle energy of trees and plants here, where the flora release so many feminine ions that the light fractures into geometric patterns that are organized along magnetic lines coherent with the tides, and sometimes visible to the naked eye. Really and truly. And some buildings here have a moist, salty dignity, even as they grow beards of stringy pale moss, green as seasick old men, and long, relaxed streets that arrive eventually where they are headed, but don't get all fascist and linear and anal like highways do, and unusual fauna right in the town sometimes, like the young elk who ate a whole box of frozen hot dogs at a school picnic once, or the black bear who wandered through the recycling shed at the Department of Public Works and tore apart a pile of newspapers and was discovered reading the New York Times travel section, turning the pages daintily, with her claws as big and sharp as steak knives. Right now, for example, look up, right over there, see the eagle flying low and fast down Curlew Street? Watch. As he sails over the grocery store, he whirls and snatches a whirling piece of cardboard, and he flap-flop-flaps down the street triumphantly, big as a tent. You can almost hear him thinking, "I am one badass flying machine. This weird flat brown bird didn't get away from me, no sir. Nothing can elude my lightning deftness in the air." Not something you see every day, an eagle chortling over a beer box, eh? And down the street goes the eagle, heading west, his capacious shadow sliding like a blanket over the elementary school, where a slim older woman with brown and silver hair and brown and green eyes is holding court over the unruly sixth grade, her eyes flashing. And over her grandson Daniel, age 12, with hair braided into three thick braids of different colors, red, black, brown, who is zooming on his bicycle just in front of a logging truck, giving the driver wiggy nightmares for a week. And over a sturdy young woman named Grace in an open meadow high on a hill, where she is slicing apart a small car with a blowtorch, her muscular right arm pumping and flexing with the torque of the torch, and the leap of her muscle making her tattoo flash like a neon sign, kiss, flash, my, flash, ass. And over a lithe woman called No Horses in her studio crammed with carving tools, as she is staring thoughtfully at a slab of oak twice as big as she is, which isn't very big at all. And over a man named Owen Cooney, who is humming in his shop crammed with automobile parts and assorted related ephemera, as his pet crow sits quietly on an old Oregon State University football helmet, watching. And over a grocer grocering, a priest priesting, a doctor doctoring, teachers teaching, two cooks cooking, a man beating his son, an insurer insuring, a woman vomiting in a creek, a banker banking, an old nun's heart faltering in her room on the top floor of the hotel, a man telling a lie in court, a teenage couple coupling on top of the blankets in the downstairs bedroom of her parents' house so as to be sure that no rumpled sheets will tell tales of their vigorous unclothedness, and so many more stories, all changing by the minute, all swirling and braiding and weaving and spinning and stitching themselves one to another, and to the stories of creatures in that place, both the quick, sharp-eyed ones and the rooted green ones and the ones underground and the ones too small to see, and to stories that used to be here and still are here in ways that you can sense sometimes if you listen with your belly, and the first green shoots of stories that will be told in years to come. So many stories braided and woven and interstitched and leading one to another like spider strands or synapses or creaks that you could listen patiently for 100 years and never hardly catch more than shards and shreds of the incalculable ocean of stories just in this one town, not big, not small, bounded by four waters, in the hills, by the coast, end of May, first salmon berries, just ripe. But you sure can try to catch a few, yes? At the west end of the main street, where it begins to slide off precipitously toward the ocean, there's a long, low building faced all around with cedar shakes. Right over this sprawling structure, the eagle turns south toward his nest, and as he wheels against the noon light, his capacious shadow slides over two elderly men at a rickety alder table in front of the long, low building, and they look up right quick.
"That thing, big as a tent," says the taller of the two. "Adult male," says the shorter man. "How can you tell from here?" "Can see his ego, the angle of his dangle."
They grin.
"Actually, I can tell it's a male," continues the shorter man, "because you notice that he's carrying a piece of cardboard, which is foolish. So there you go." "Gratuitous slur on our gender," says the taller man. "Men, the final frontier," answers his companion, "as your lovely bride says."
The two men are drinking beer and eating salmon berries. Between them is one empty beer bottle. They split a beer every day at lunch. They work together in the long, low building behind them. They are, collectively, the Department of Public Works. They have public work together for more than 40 years in various jobs. They are the best of friends. They are in their late 60s, they think. They are not totally sure about their ages because neither of them is in possession of a real, actual birth certificate, for reasons they were too young to learn at the time. The salmon berries are the first of the season, and the two men are eating them very slowly, tasting every bittersweet orange-yellow acidic drop, and then slowly sipping the beer, a tongueful, a thimbleful at a time.
"Yum," says the taller of the two men.
"Yup," says the other.
"Not everyone likes salmon berries," Vulgarians?
I am told they are an acquired taste.
Vulgarians?
Salmon berries.
Yeah. Listen, this afternoon we have to get back to work on the oral history project. We promised that we would get back to work on it the day after the rain stopped, and the rain stopped last night, and we have got to get to work. We're behind something awful on the oral history project.
One of our best ideas, absolutely. Whose idea was that?
Yours?
Was it?
You were going on interminably one day about how one way to defeat time is by recording every story possible, not only from people, but from everything living.
For everything that lives is holy, says Blake.
Yeah, you said that. Also, you said that with the project, we could build an impregnable bulwark against entropy. I remember you saying that because you hardly ever hear the word entropy. Excellent word.
Or impregnable, says the taller man, thoughtfully. Unable to be made pregnant? I have to confess, says the taller man, that I was under the impression that you invented the project as part of your vast and overweening ambition.
Nope, your idea. It fits the expanded public works idea beautifully, though. What a resource, eh? Here's what I want to do this afternoon. I want to record osprey calls along the river. Those high screams, you know? Piercing sound. On a May day, as they're finishing their nests. I wonder if they're speaking in a different tone now than midsummer or early fall. These are the things to know. Let's add that to the list of things to know. Oh, thank God for computers. Remember when the things to know was on paper? My God! We had to buy that barn just to keep the reams of things to know. That was crazy.
Listen, says the taller man. I've been thinking.
Did it hurt?
Listen, my friend, says the taller man, holding on to his line of talk like a rope. Did you ever consider that maybe the scope of public works as we have conceived it is too big altogether? I mean, other towns and cities use their departments just to fix roads and sewer lines and stream beds and such.
We do those things.
But we also are prey to what I might call a vast and overweening ambition. I mean, really, to preserve history, collect stories, repair marriages, prevent crime, augment economic status, promote chess, manage insect populations, run sports leagues. Isn't that a bit much? We even give haircuts.
Are we doing insects? Did I know that?
I'm teasing. But we try to do everything.
Not everything.
I think maybe too much.
I think not enough, says the shorter man.
Don't you ever think we could be wrong? Asks the tall man.
Billy, says the shorter man, this is why people call you worried man.
Cedar, my friend, says the taller man, not smiling, I worry we are arrogant.
Cedar leans over the table and stares his friend in the eye. Billy, he says quietly, Billy, we heal things. That's what we do. That's why we're here. We've always agreed on that, right from the start. We do as well as we can. We fail a lot, but we keep after it. What else can we do? We have brains that still work, so we have to apply them to pain. Brains against pain, that's the motto. That's the work. That's what we do. Soon enough, we will not have brains that work, so, therefore.
We could stop interfering, says the tall man. Who are we to talk to that young woman, for example, Grace?
Who else would say anything to her?
Her family.
What family? Her mother's gone, her brothers are donkeys, and the father isn't much in the way of a moral compass, let's put it that way. Look, Billy, what good are we to anyone if we are not ambitious to make a difference? If we don't use our brains, we're just two old men fixing potholes. Are potholes enough, my friend? I think not.
I watch that girl's face as we talk to her, says Worried Man.
She was humiliated. You know it, and I know it. Her face stays with me. Was that right? Did we have the right to sting her like that? Is that the purview of the Public Works Department, to embarrass the public? To speak to her honestly about her behavior is to care about her, Billy. In a way, it is to love her.
Is it?
Isn't it?
Is it?
They drain the last thick, dense, bitter drops of their beer. Owen says today is Joan of Arc's feast day, says Cedar, standing up to go.
Her name wasn't Joan, says Worried Man, also rising. It was Jeanne, Jeanne La Pucelle of Domremy.
Brave child by any name, says Cedar.
She was a meddler, too, and look what happened to her, poor thing, says Worried Man.
She changed the face of history, says Cedar.
She was roasted to death one morning, and her ashes were thrown in the river, and the men who murdered her also managed to murder her real name throughout history, says Worried Man.
They bow and part. Cedar to visit a client, as he says, and then to the river to record Osprey calls, and Worried Man to his office in the department to record an answer to this question from his grandson Daniel. How did my mother get her name?
2. This is me, Worried Man, making a tape for my grandson Daniel about how his mother, who is my daughter, got her name. Well, no horses got her name because our people were the best horse stealers ever. By our people, I mean the people, capital P. We who have lived here in the Coast Hills longer than even our stories remember. We were terrific horse stealers. We were awesome. No one could steal horses like us, and stealing a horse is hard. I mean, the creature weighs half a ton, and they're skittery, and they're smart, some of them, and they know they're not supposed to hustle off quietly into the bushes in the middle of the night. They're supposed to stand drowsily in the milky dew until the morning when they get to eat again. Horses just want to eat. Anyway, you have to get to the scene silently, sometimes slipping past sentries and sentinels, and then you establish an immediate rapport with the horse, silently, of course, and then detach all ropes and hobbles and such, and then you calm the horse and lead him away, past the sentinels again. And the fact is that slipping past a sharp-eared sentinel with a confused, fat, half-ton animal is no easy matter, as you can imagine. Well, if you got caught, they'd slice your throat. I'm always hearing about counting coup in battle in the old days, where a guy at great risk to life and limb touches his enemy with a coup stick, escaping with great acclaim and all, but what's the point? I mean, you touched a guy with a stick. Big deal. I'd rather risk life and limb and come out of the fray with a horse. Now that's an accomplishment. You got something to show for your labors. Well, one time we were burying in the valleys east of here, boiling berries into cakes, cooling the cakes in the creeks, and packing down horses with enough berry cakes to choke a small whale, an orca, maybe. Though they'd eat anything, coyotes of the ocean. Of course, to carry the cakes back here to Neawanaka, we needed horses, because this was before everyone and their aunt had a truck. We had a lot of horses. These were fine animals, absolutely, and they needed to be guarded carefully by stalwart sentinels with sharp ears and sharp eyes. I was chosen as sentinel, being then young and sinewy, and in the fullness of my itchy first strength. But I was also in the fullness of my first cocky stupidity, and I had boasted that I could pick more berries than any other man or woman, and also be a sharp-eared and sharp-eyed sentinel. And it turns out I was wrong. On the third night, I was so tired and sore that I fell asleep. And that's when horse thieves from the valley made their move. They slipped up on me,
and under my horse blanket they affixed 4 long, thin poles of red cedar, willowy, whippy things, and then ever so gently, ever so daintily, they lifted me on the blanket and propped up the poles so that they could gently urge the fat fool horse out from under me, which they did, and left me propped up in the air, sound asleep. Then they unhobbled our horses and silently made away with all of them, 12 of the finest horses you ever saw. The next morning was difficult. We all walked home, of course, a very long walk, all my former friends jeering and cursing, and all of us carrying those damn berry cakes. And when we got to Neawanaka, everyone was hooting and jeering and telling the story of how I fell asleep. And I have to say that there was a lot of embroidering going on. I know a little about embroidering stories myself, as you know, but this was wholesale embroidering, all sorts of exaggeration, really not suitable at all to the occasion. My young, pregnant wife, Maplehead, was waiting for me in the little cedar cabin we'd been given by her parents, where we live still, as you know, and when I came in to see her, she swung her legs over the side of the bed and stood up and asked about all the hooting and hollering and jeering and embroidering, and I felt that I had better tell her the story myself, so she would get a fairly accurate version of a very unusual event. So I did. She laughed, snorted, chortled, wept with laughter, rolled on the floor, guffawed, howled, and etc. absolutely. She laughed so hard, in short, my little thimbleberry, that she went into labor on the spot, and a few minutes later your mother was born. And that is how your mother received her name, which is, as you know, No Horses. And that is the end of that story.
3. Neawanaka has been a settlement of one size or another for perhaps 5,000 years. Human beings lived here for all the normal reasons you can name. It is well watered, with small but persistent creeks to the north and south, a small but serious river running right smack through town, and an ocean. There are trout in the creeks. Salmon and steelhead run up the river in creeks seasonally, and perch and halibut and cod and such swim not too far offshore. There are so many fish of so many kinds in and around the town that for perhaps 5,000 years the name of the town was So Many Fish, in the native tongue spoken here. There are deer and elk in the spruce and cedar forests. It hardly ever snows in winter and hardly ever bakes in summer. It does get an unbelievable amount of rain, nearly 200 inches one year, according to Cedar, who measures such things, and the rain starts in November and doesn't really end as a continuous moist narrative until July. But then those next 4 months are crisp and sunny and extraordinary times, when every living creature, from the pale cloudberry close to the ground to the eagles the size of tents floating overhead, is grinning and exuberant. And there is, of course, an amazing amount of wood growing here, spruce and alder mostly, although there's some big cedar and hemlock still in the more remote ravines, where loggers couldn't and still can't easily log. And there are more bushes and plants than you can shake a shrub at, most of them providing some sort of food or use, and there are grouse in the spruce thickets also, and a little quail with a topknot that makes really good eating, if only you can catch it. So, all in all, there is enough food to get by, and enough material to easily build shelter, and weather that doesn't set out grimly to kill you, as Cedar says of some other weathers he has known. So people have lived here probably from the first couple of days after the glaciers slid away, muttering, or from the first day that a little boat filled with exhausted people from elsewhere landed on the beach, or in the mouth of the Mink River. Howsoever the first people arrived in this little green cupped hand of a place, they stayed. And like all people everywhere, when eventually they encountered other groups of people, and the other people wanted to know what the people living in the cupped green hand called themselves,
The cupped green hand people looked at each other's faces and cleared their throats uncertainly and met briefly to confer, and then emerged from their confab, harumphed, rattled their weapons, and said, "Why, we are, well, of course, what else would we be? The people." 4. This is me, a worried man, making another tape for Daniel about how I met my friend Cedar. Well, about 40 years ago, Maplehead and I were courting on the Mink River. We were way up in the hills near its source to the east. East in rivers of bliss. Blake. We were pretending to be fishing, but really we were learning how to make love. We were trying all sorts of ways of making love to see how we fit together as bodies and companions, without family and friends around us to shape us with their emotions and expectations, and seeing what ways of making love made us deeper with each other, and what ways were just acrobatics or showing off. We were trying to make love absolutely, with every muscle and every shred of our attention. Maybe, thinking about it now, we were trying to figure out how to make love in such a way as to make time not matter at all, or defeat it for a while. Which we did, for a while. I'll say no more. Hand in hand, wandering, terrified of each other's beauty. Blake. Well, we were there by the Mink, and we were actually fishing that afternoon, and we were sore and tired and happy, and to be honest, neither of us planned on fishing very long at all, and as I remember, your grandmother and I were already casting eyes at each other more than we were casting for fish, but then I noticed a person's body going past me in the river, and everything changed absolutely from that moment. I waded in fast and grabbed that body. For a not very big body, it seemed awfully heavy, and I couldn't tell if it was an alive body or a dead body. But I was young and strong then, and not afraid of dead things, which are only cousins to living things, so I hauled with all my might and got it up on the riverbank through the ferns. Sword fern, I think. Maybe bracken. The body was naked and brown and face down in the grass, and I flipped it over and it turned out to be a man, who turned out to be Cedar, who turned out to be alive, although awfully waterlogged. We didn't know he was Cedar right at that moment, of course, and of course neither did he know he was Cedar right then, because he had been in the river a long time and was nearly completely drowned. I'd say he was about 90% drowned. He was awfully full of river, which is probably why Cedar is such a thing for rivers and rain. Heck, he lived inside the river for a while, which you can't say about many people, especially living ones. Anyway, when Maplehead saw me haul Cedar out of the river, she came sprinting through the fern like a deer. A lovely sight, absolutely. That woman could bound and float like a swallow, and still does when she walks, if you pay close attention. She knelt down and looked into Cedar's face, and he had just opened his eyes and seen me and realized that he wasn't drowned. And when he saw her face, he smiled, and she smiled, and he said, "I like your face better than his." And we all laughed, although then I decided to throw him back in the river. But I didn't, which was a good thing, because he turned out to be Cedar. We brought him home, and he recovered pretty quickly. But he never could remember how he got to be in the river, or where his clothes were, or anything at all from before we fished him out. All he could remember was that his name was Cedar. He knew that much. So that's how Cedar didn't drown. Lately, I have been absorbed by bicycle repair, and so I must conclude this tape. I have repaired 17 bicycles in the past month, during which time I have become fascinated by spokes, which are really wires, and now I am utterly into wires, weight-bearing capacity, elegance, metaphor. They are so thin and taut and lithe, like your grandmother. I have some very interesting ideas about wiring and strength and the webbing of time, the structural basics of time, you understand, and they must be pursued apace, life being short but not brutish, so I must go. That is the end of this story.
5. There are halibut as big as doors in the ocean down below the town, flap-skimming on the murky ocean floor, with vast skates and rays and purple crabs and black cod large as logs, and sea lions slashing through the whip forests of bull kelp and eelgrass and sugar rack, and seals in the rockweed and giant perennial kelp and iridescent kelp and iridescent fish and luminous shrimp too small to see with the naked eye, but billions of which feed the gray whales, which slide hugely, slowly by, like rubbery zeppelins twice a year, north in spring and south in fall. Salmon berries, thimbleberries, black raspberries, gooseberries, bearberries, snowberries, salal berries, elderberries, blackberries along the road and by the seasonal salt marshes north and south. The ground squirrels burrow along the dirt banks of the back roads, their warren of mysterious holes, the thick scatter of fine brown soil before their doorsteps, the flash of silver-gray on their back fur as they rocket into the bushes, the bucks and does and fawns in the road in the morning, their springy step as they slip away from the flower gardens they have been eating, the bobcat seen once at dusk, its haunches jacked up like a teenager's hot-rodding car, the rumor of cougar in the hills, the coyotes who use the old fire road in the hills, the tiny mice and bats one sometimes finds long dead and leathery, like ancient brown paper, the little frenetic, testy, chittering, skittering, cheeky, testy, chicory squirrels in the spruces and pines. Douglas squirrels, they are, their very name remembering that young gentleman botanist who wandered near these hills centuries ago. The herons in marshes and sinks and creeks and streams and on the beach sometimes at dusk. And the cormorants and pelicans and sea scoters and murres, poor things, so often dead young on the beach after the late spring fledging. And jays, and crows, and quarking haunted ravens, moaning poo, poo at dusk, especially over the wooded hills, and the goldfinches mobbing thistles in the meadowed hills, and sometimes a falcon rocketing by like a gleeful murderous dream, an osprey of all sizes all along the Mink, like an osprey police lineup, and the herring gulls, and Caspian terns, and Arctic terns, and the varied thrushes in wet corners of thickets, and the ruffed grouse in the spruce by the road, and the quail sometimes, and red-tailed hawks floating, floating, floating. From below, they look like kites soaring brownly against the piercing blue sky, which itself is a vast creature bluer by the month as summer deepens into crisp, cold fall. 6. Maplehead is in the 6th grade classroom at the school. She is the teacher. The school is on the west side of town at the edge of the spruce forest. She is standing by the chalkboard. The school building was once a barn. She is a slim brown woman with long, rich, curling silver hair, with brown leaping in it. The children call her teacher. The lesson this afternoon is geometry, radius, diameter, circumference. Her eyes are brown and green, and when she is angry, the green parts of her eyes flash like fish leaping in a river. Barn swallows still nest in the school. She is glaring at the O'Donnell boys, who are, as usual, causing a ruckus. They are 16 and 14, and are guests in class today because of general recklessness and boneheadery and lazitude and punishness and detentiary.
O'Donnells have lived in Neawanaka for more than a century. They were among the Irish Catholics who came after the Hunger and rooted here, because the land was no good for farming, so nobody wanted to steal it from the people, or shove the gaunt, ragged foreigners off it. Green fish are leaping furiously in her eyes. The O'Donnells were fishing people, mostly. Maplehead is a very good teacher and a kind woman through and through, but at the moment she is entertaining fishy green thoughts about the O'Donnell twins and their motley clan in general, and she contemplates her heavy ruler made of hemlock and the mule heads of the O'Donnells and the closet with the lock in the basement of the school, where one might, if one were so inclined, cram two O'Donnells. But she doesn't, although fish are leaping all over the place in her eyes. Her grandson Daniel should be in her class, but instead he is in his father's shop. He was sent over with a school typewriter to be repaired, and he is lingering in the shop. He loves the inky, oily smells there. He is a round boy with hair in three long braids of three different colors, red, black, brown, like his hero, the legendary Irish warrior Cuchulainn. Daniel's eyes are brown with green flashes. He sits in the third row, third seat. He is 12 years old. He likes to play basketball and read and ride his bike. He makes friends easily because he likes to listen, and he is almost always cheerful, even with girls. He thinks about girls all the time. He likes to ride his bike in the woods as fast as he can go. Girls are beginning to think about him. A month ago, he began to write poems and observations in a small black notebook that he hides in his closet. Two girls in particular think about him a lot, but don't say anything to anyone about their thoughts. He is ashamed of hiding his book, but he cannot imagine showing it to his parents. He would be horrified if they read what he wrote. He is writing about himself. No Horses is in her studio at the Department of Public Works, the long, low-slung building with the cedar shakes on the east side of town, where the hillside falls away to moist meadows down below. The meadows are brown and green, and her eyes are brown and green. Her studio is at the south end of the building to get the most light. Her husband Owen built a little deck at that end and cut a door to it and cut a door-sized piece of glass for it. He's good with his hands that way. The door is shaped like No Horses, a little humorous touch of Owen's. He's good with his head that way. There are two chairs on the deck, and a little round table, and a hummingbird feeder. Often, from the deck, she sees elk in the meadows, and hovering buzzards, occasionally a bald eagle. Once, a young bear. Once, a red-tailed hawk with a snake in its mouth, an image so immediately arresting that she ran from the window to her workbench and started a sculpture in sandstone that isn't working yet, though she has hopes. 7. The doctor is in his office at the north end of town, where the hill dives gently down toward the dunes. He has three patients left to see. They are waiting in his waiting room. One is coughing so hard that the second has a vision of him coughing his organs onto the floor, one at a time. Spleen, kidneys, liver, gallbladder, in a steaming pile on the rug. The doctor is a small, neat, dark man, with eyeglasses. The third patient sells boxes and containers of all sizes. The doctor has stepped out back to smoke a cigarette. The third patient likes to say that he sells air with boundaries. The doctor is on the 10th of his 12 daily cigarettes, one for each apostle, as he says. The third patient has a raging pain in his belly that will kill him in about 3 weeks. The third patient privately suspects that something is fatally wrong inside him, but he has said nothing to anyone. The doctor is unmarried, but he has private hopes. The third patient has thought seriously of telling his daughter about his fears, but he has refrained. No one is sure of the doctor's age. He is the sort of lean, leathery man who could be 40 or 60. The third patient has refrained from telling his daughter about his pain, although he feels closer to her than to anyone else in the world, because she has just fallen in love with a boy, and she just lost her virginity to him. And she's pretty proud now of being a woman. But the boyfriend is sleeping with another girl also, which he hasn't told the third patient's daughter. The doctor will confirm the third patient's fears in about 30 minutes. The third patient's daughter will find out that her boyfriend is a liar in about 3 weeks. 8. Grace O'Donnell is in the barn on her parents' farm, patching tractor tires and cursing in new and interesting ways to make her brothers laugh. She spent the morning cutting apart a car with a blowtorch, and she is due out on a fishing boat in another hour, but she swore, so to speak, that she would get to the tires today, because her father is now in his 70s, and while he is still healthy and still mean, he can no longer easily bend over and pick up heavy tools, although he never admits or tells anyone that, because he is Red Hugh, hard of hand and head, chief of the clan, asking no help or quarter, quick to lash fools and children with his long white rod on Slaw Bawn. Although he doesn't dare lash Grace or Declan anymore, because of Grace's cold eyes on him when he loses his temper and reaches for the stick, and because Declan told his father one afternoon in the meadow that if you ever raise that feckin' stick at me again, I'll yank it out of your feckin' hand and cram it down your feckin' throat. You hear me, old man? You hear me? Grace notices that Red Hugh can no longer easily bend over and pick up heavy tools, so she patches the tires. She gets 3 tires patched before she notices that the first tire she patched is already flat again, and this sets her going on a fit of cursing that, even for her, is inspired stuff. And she has been swearing like a cuckolded sailor since she was 7 years old. It is a skill she learned in part from Red Hugh, a master curser who starts cursing even before he gets out of bed, and Hugh can still get a good burst going, given the right conditions, although he can't sustain an hour's worth of snarling invective like he could in the old days, and not that any of his children miss his bile, which is now directed wholly at his wife, who isn't there to hear it, because she packed a suitcase 2 years ago and walked out the door without a word. The suitcase was enormous. It was far too big for her to carry. The sound of it being dragged down the gravel driveway will stay with Grace and her brothers forever and ever and ever. 9. Owen and his pet crow Moses are in his shop at the south end of town, where the highway is. Officially, his shop is called Auto and Other Repair, but Other Repair is the greater part by far of his business. The shop is split into 2 large rooms, one oily and fragrant and filled with many pieces of cars, and the other filled mostly with tables and shelves on which sit several thousand things and pieces of things, among them Moses, who likes to sit on an old football helmet over the long bench where Owen works. It is a heroic clutter. It is the clutter's dream of clutter. Close your eyes for a minute and think of all the closets you have ever crammed with stuff, and all the basement workbenches asprawl with tools, and the shelves crowded with fishing gear and sports equipment and paintbrushes and furnace filters and nails and eyelets and grommets and washers and such, and merge them all in your mind, not haphazardly, but with a general sense of order, a relaxed and affectionate organizational sense, such that you would have a pretty good rough idea where something might be if you needed to find it, and when you went to look for it, you would find it in less than a minute. And even when something took more than a minute to find, you would find something else that you'd been looking for, not desperately, but assiduously. Then think of all the rich, dark, male smells you have ever liked. The smells that remind you of your dad, your grandfather, your uncle, your older brother. Paint in cans that have been imperfectly sealed, so a touch of the smell leaks out. And flat, whippy, paint-stirring sticks, half-coated in dried paint atop the cans. And if you are really good with the nerves of the expansive nostrils, as Blake says, you could maybe distinguish the color of the paint from the smells. The vanilla smell of white paint, and the fragrant baby smell of blue. The loud smell of red, like a car backfiring. The library smell of brown. And the smells of sawn cedar and maple and fir boards. Ashes. Varnish. Plywood. Cigars. somewhere on a shelf, a redolent piece of redwood. Sweat. Boots. Oil. A hint of gasoline, as if it had been spilled quite a long time ago and cleaned up meticulously, but the room remembers when it happened. Rubber. The cold, impersonal, greedy smell of metal. Sawdust. The handled smell of tools. Liniment. Coffee. The brown smell of boxes and cardboard. Beer. The vacation cabin smell of pine. Oiled saws. Old newspapers. Wood smoke. The burnt wire smell of old radio and television tubes. Turpentine. The grandmotherly smell of old upholstery rising warmly from the sagging couch in the corner. Apples. Wet clothes. Bread. Crow. Its stew of smells and sense of ragged order was the very essence of Owen's shop. Children loved it on first sight, and old men felt so comfortable there that they would bring Owen things to fix that he knew and they knew didn't need fixing, although he charged a flat fee of $10 per job for such things, which the old men paid happily, figuring that $10 was the fair cost of an afternoon spent poking around other repair, which they also loved because Owen let them poke around freely, without rebuff or boundaries, although he politely declined their inevitable requests to actually repair things, though unanimously they offered to work for nothing, and many of them had offered to pay for the privilege. Owen's son, Daniel, recently began a list of the things in this room. Watches, alarm clocks, toasters, tape recorders, tape decks, microwave ovens, lawnmowers, half a boat, telephones, computers, kitchen clocks, chairs, tables, televisions, screws, bolts, an alarm system for a boat, answering machines, global positioning devices, fish finders, fishing reels, hedge clippers, scissors, shears, trowels, the bottom half of an ancient cotton gin, a Beretta pistol, welding tools, hammers, pliers of every conceivable size. Owen maintains that the pliers is the greatest tool ever invented. Saws, screwdrivers, an anvil, winches in three sizes, Moses, and taxidermy tools, which is where Daniel stopped recording what he saw, because the tools were being applied to the top half of a huge beaver, and Daniel wanted to help, which he did, to the quiet pleasure of his father. 10. Cedar pays a visit to the man who beats his son. The man works at the fish co-op. His son is in the 8th grade. They live alone. They moved here a year ago from away, the man and the boy. The father beats the son, only inside the house. The son no longer cries when he is beaten, but tries to make his mind soar out of his body like a bird, while the father back on earth is punching and kicking him in the chest and ribs. When the father loses his temper, he swings at his son's face, and once he has begun swinging, he cannot stop, although he shifts his punches to the boy's chest and ribs so as not to leave marks. And when the boy falls to the floor and curls up, the father kicks him with his work boots. The son lifts weights 3 times a day. When the father is exhausted from beating the boy, he goes out on the porch and sobs, with great, silent, racking sobs. And the boy goes to the freezer, where he has ice packs arranged by size, and a fishing vest he has stuffed with ice. The boy explains his bruises in the gym by saying that he also lifts at home and is clumsy with the weights. The father feels twisted and foul. The boy has run away 2x. The father beats the son 2 or 3 times a week. The second time the boy ran away, Michael the cop found him sleeping in a cave on the beach in a sleeping bag made of old jackets wrapped with duct tape. Michael told Cedar about the boy. Cedar stands outside the back door of the co-op. "Tell me the thoughts of man that have been hid of old," he thinks. Blake. He steps into the co-op. The father is cleaning a catch of scallops at a long table. The air inside the co-op is bone cold. Weather vane scallops, Cedar notes. The public works computer in his head, automatically gauging their size. The man is sweating as he wields the shucking knife. Flick, flick, flick. The nuggets of scallop meat fly from the knife into a steel bowl. You will keep your hands off that boy, says Cedar quietly. And the man's head snaps up, but his knife keeps shucking. Flick, flick, flick. When the rage comes, you will walk out of the house with your hands in your pockets, says Cedar. And the knife stops flicking, and there is no sound at all in the room. Your love for him will heal you, says Cedar. And the man drops the knife and whirls around, but Cedar pins the man's arms to his sides with a grip of stone and doom, and he leans in closer and says, Your love will heal your boy also. The man spits a huge gob of spit in Cedar's face, and Cedar puts his dripping nose against the man's scarlet nose and says, very quietly, If you hit that boy again, I will break your fucking wrists like fucking twigs. And the man says nothing. And there is no sound at all in the room except the two men breathing hard and the refrigeration unit chuffing. 11.
That is one honkin' huge beaver, Dad. Tez. Where's it from?
The Mink River. Grace found it drowned.
Must weigh 50 pounds. You know, prehistoric beavers weighed maybe 500 pounds or more. They were the size of cars.
Really?
Really, really.
And they were smart.
Imagine a really, really smart beaver the size of a car.
Yikes.
Imagine you're in the river, waist deep, fooling around, and you see coming towards you a furry car that's thinking maybe you're getting a little too close to its lodge, which is itself the size of a city. You'd pee so fast you'd raise the river.
You make me laugh.
You know, I love this, when we work together.
Yeah.
I do, really.
Me too.
Soon you'll be off to college.
Oh, not for years, Dad. And who knows what will happen then?
You sound like my dad. He was always leery of the future.
Why?
Good question. Well, he was leery of the present and past, too, come to think of it. He was a leery guy. Ha! Guy Leery. Sounds like a movie star.
Leery of what?
Of what would happen, I guess. Or not happen.
Was he paranoid?
Paranoid. Not really, no. He was a tough man. Very brave, in his way. He was just worried. It was always in his face. A worried man, so to speak. Should have called him worried man and not your other grandpa. My dad never trusted that things would work his way, is the best way to put it. So they never did.
You're cutting the beaver's ear off.
Ah, so I am. Shit on a stick. Damn my eyes. Never talk and work. The work suffers.
You were saying?
Well, my dad had a hard life, Dano. He was a child of the hunger, in a way, on Buchel Gorta. And he never found work he really wanted to do, and I think he was lonely all his life.
Until he met grandmother.
Well, he was lonely after that, too.
Tell me.
Let's finish the beaver first.
You should tell your dad's story for the project.
I could that. Your Grandpa Billy would like that.
Grandpa's making tapes for me.
How so?
Answering questions I ask.
Like?
How Mom got her name? How he met Cedar?
Ask him how a young Irish fellow from County Mudden Blood bamboozled his one extraordinary daughter off him. He'll laugh at that.
Grandpa has a great laugh.
He does that. Ask him how a young fellow with no prospects and education and hair black as the inside of a dog, somehow against all odds and sense, persuaded the stunning no-horses to marry him. Ask him, was it some Celtic druidry, or what, that won me my wild wee wife?
How did you meet Mom?
Ah,
There's 1,000 tapes in that story, son.
Did you ask Mom to get married, or did she ask you?
I sank to my knees, son, on the highest hill I could find, and I asked her it straight out, with my heart hammering and yammering and warbling and whistling like a water bird in my ribs. And she smiled that sideways smile and said, "Yes."
And your daddy has been a capering fox every minute since, with few exceptions, absolutely, as your grandpa would say. And now, to the beaver.
12. No Horses in Her Studio is a study of alternating currents of motion and stillness. A river racing and resting. Electric femininity waxing and waning. When her hands are in motion, the rest of her is still, and vice versa. Often she walks in circles like her father, around her work table, around the room, around the department building when she's really frazzled and has to think out a piece of work, around the hills on which Neawanaka perches when she can't work at all and has to go burn off the throttled electricity. At work in clay or wood or stone, she stares. She breathes evenly. She is riveted. She is lost. No phone, music gently. Bach, when she is in stone, rock and roll in clay, jazz in wood. This afternoon there is a slab of spruce on her work table, weighing perhaps 200 pounds, as tall and broad in the shoulders as a man.
Maybe it will be a man, she thinks.
She circles the table.
I like men, she thinks, smiling. By God, she thinks, I'll make a man. I'll make one from scratch, my new man. Be fun to tell Owen.
She checks, grinning, to see if there is a knob in the right place to make a man. Keep circling the table. She never touches a raw piece of clay or wood or stone until she gets a feeling about it. And once the feeling comes, she chooses her tools carefully, balancing various chisels and gouges in her hands to see who wants to work today. Choosing music carefully for pace. She puts on Miles Davis and then reconsiders and puts on Chet Baker.
No genius today, she thinks. Just dreaming. Just the right music by which to make a man, she grins. And oh, how very many men have been made to the music of Chet Baker.
Thinks about making love to Owen. His lips and hips arrowing into her. Such bony, relentless hips, she thinks. In the rest of her studio are blocks and slabs and chunks of wood. Maple, cedar, fir, more oak, walnut, alder, spruce, hemlock, cherry, ash, laurel, elm, myrtle, redwood. Sawdust and shavings and chips on the floor, like tiny frozen leaves. There are tools everywhere. Racks of chisels and gouges, mallets and mallet heads, planers, jointers, table saws, circular saws, chainsaws, and bandsaws. There are routers, drills, sanders, clamps, glues, oils, finishes, a huge hydraulic hoist, and carving benches with attached wood vices, and sharpeners everywhere. There are more sharpeners than anything else in the room. Daniel counted them recently. 39, his mother's age.
13. Cedar on the Mink River, sitting and thinking, watching the ripples. His recording equipment whirring in the fern of the riverbank. Ospreys rowing through the air above. Two adults, two young. Mergansers, kingfishers, ouzel on the river. Water, water, river, river, talking, talking. He hears the low bass booming of rocks being turned over by the river, like a low mutter.
Basso? Baritone?
He watches the ouzel and thinks of No Horses. Smiles. She is his goddaughter, and the affection he felt for her during her childhood and adolescence has grown into a real respect for the woman she has become.
No Horses. She is one tough woman, he thinks. Lovely, strong, patient,
talented, kind. My sweet little Nora. But he thinks uneasily of the talk they had this morning in her studio, after he and Owen wrestled the spruce slab onto her carving table, and Owen long-legged it back to his shop. A hard talk. A talk about holes. It began as a talk about carving holes in wood, and then spun into holes in people. Things missing. Or, as she said, the feeling that something was missing that you'd never had and hadn't known you didn't have, until suddenly you knew it. He chews on that remark for a while, as the ospreys row in their floating lines up and down the river.
14. Dad, says Daniel.
Yeah?
Tell me how you met Mom.
I should save it for a project tape.
Tell me now?
Oh, it's a long story, son. Suitable for telling by the fire.
But Mom will be there.
Is that bad?
You'll look at her.
And?
You know what I mean. When she's in the room, your eyes go there.
When she's in the room, the temperature rises, boyo.
Dad, that's gross.
Good thing for you, I love your mama, and versa vice.
I love her too, Dad, but sometimes...
Sometimes what?
Sometimes you pay more attention to her than you do to me.
I don't.
You do?
You don't mean that.
It's okay. I don't mind. Sometimes I mind.
Well, when you're married...
You pay too much attention to Mom.
What?
Does she pay that much attention to you?
Sure she does. Sure now.
15. Moses the crow barks once, and Daniel looks up at the 7 clocks mounted above the workbench and says, "Gotta go, Dad," and hustles out of the shop and sails back to school on his bike, his braids flying, red, black, brown. He wants to be back in class just before school ends. Owen keeps rebuilding the beaver, but now his mind is all awash and awander with no horses.
We met on this beach. Salt and sea. We were walking each alone, me north, she south. In the afternoon. The way she walks, leaning forward, her hair pouring out behind her like a river. A comet's tail. Oh, that hair is black as the back of midnight. Uncoolin, the maiden of the flowing locks.
When we passed on the strand, we paused. And her eyes flashed, and her hair whipped around her face.
Mail onagar, oton stod van vra, wo gaul. Red ripening in her cheeks, like a berry on a tree.
Her graceful neck, her lips like bruised fruit. I never saw anyone or anything like her ever. There was a zest in her eye. I wanted to say something courteous and memorable, but out of my mouth, to my utter surprise, fell Chalin Yasmachri, dear girl of my heart. Because she had me all flustered there in the salty wind, and I was so surprised at myself I laughed, and she laughed, a sound like the peal of a silver bell. And she said, "What language is that?" And I said, "Oh, that's the old Irish. Walk with me, and I'll teach you a bit." I was surprised at my own boldness, but do worry to mention. She made my mind all feeble with her eyes. "I will walk with you," she said. And we walked along, trading words in our old languages, me in the Irish and her in the Salish. And soon we were trading stories in American. And soon after that, we were trading salty kisses in our own language, her long hair whirling around us like the salty arms of the salty sea. 16. Worried man notes the hour. Golden russet slanting light. The hour when the angle of the sun heading toward the ocean illuminates everything seemingly from inside, so that plants glow greenly with their bright green souls naked to the naked joyous eye. Bright angelic wings bespangling every bough like stars. Blake. And he sets off on his rounds.
around the Department of Public's work building, one circumference, for luck, and to check the mildewing southwest corner of the building, where Cedar has his rain gauge. Then up Hawk Street to the doctor's to collect the doctor. Then Lark to Heron, to Myrrh, to Cormorant, to Warbler, to Chickadee, which has only the one resident, Mrs. L., who hands him berries or pears, depending, whose pain is in her wrists and knees. He can feel her grinding soreness as they turn into Chickadee. When they get to her gate, she hands him a little soft paper box of salmon berries, which he hands to the doctor. As the doctor asks her about her pills and such, worried man rubs her wrists. His huge hands are beaver tails, maple leaves, baby halibut. He notices that the berry box is deftly made of yesterday's newspapers. From Mrs. L's, they take the old sand quarry road, now half overgrown with young alder, to the other end of town, where the few houses huddle in a rough circle around a seasonal marsh, waist-deep in winter and dry in summer. Around the dell they go, on these streets that have no names, streets known by who lives on them, and then down the beach stairs to the water. By now the sun's nearly in the ocean, and the tide's mostly out, and they brisk along, stride for stride, silent, meditative. This is the real edge of the town, this strand of sand and sea wrack, the shells of Dungeness crabs, a sneaker here and there from a wreck at sea, a fishing float occasionally, a shard of wood, bones, sticks, logs, sometimes a dead seal or sea lion or shark, once a doe that maybe fell from a cliff, once a humpback whale, sometimes very much alive sea lions who are really big and bark like dogs and move much faster than you might imagine, once a dead man. As they near the river, they pass the keel of the Carmarthen Castle, which wrecked there more than half a century ago. "Welsh," says the doctor, not slowing. "Hmm?" "Wheat and timber, sailing from California to Oregon." "Why did it wreck?" The captain, who was roaring drunk on an unbelievably foggy night, turned into the Mink, thinking it was the mighty Columbia River, and discovered he was wrong. The whole load of timber slid into the Mink. Some was teak. Note that the O'Donnell barn has a lovely teak door. The only fatality? A rooster that had three times been around Cape Horn. Worried man stops suddenly. "You feel it?" says the doctor, quietly. "Mm-hmm." The doctor stands silently for a minute, while worried man casts about for the pain in the air. He has tried to explain to the doctor, and to Cedar, and to his wife, that he doesn't hear or smell or feel the aura of someone else's pain. He just, well, catches it, sort of. "I just am apprised of its existence, sort of," he says. "What does it feel like?" "Like electricity, in a way," says worried man. "But there's a sort of screaming or tearing in it. A chattering. It's hard to explain."
"Where is it?"
Nearby. Up.
Can you tell?"
"A woman."
The doctor, discreet, bows gently and heads back to his house. Worried man, equally discreet, waits until the doctor turns the corner, and then he heads uphill, away from the ocean. "The night falls thick," he thinks. "I go upon my watch. Blake."
17. Daniel arrives, panting for dramatic emphasis, with only 5 minutes to go before the last bell rings. His grandmother glares at him, but he is smart enough not to smile. And then the bell rings, and the class flutters and rustles and sprints and bustles off, and Maplehead crooks her finger at Daniel to come to the desk. And as he shuffles to the front of the class, he looks closely at her eyes under her thunderstorm eyebrows, but sees no green fish leaping. So he smiles.
"I'm sorry, Graham. I'll only be half a minute, you said." "Sorry? Hmm. You know what Dad's shop is like, Graham." "Oh, all right. You missed geometry." "I know it all. Test me. Just do the questions after chapter 5 tonight. How's your dad?
Stuffin' a beaver.
Ooh, sentence of the day. Where'd he get it?
Grace.
Walk home with me?
Okay, Graham.
He rides his bike slowly, standing up on the pedals, and she floats smoothly over the fresh-washed asphalt, her feet, feathers, and songs. The rising wind pours her hair into the air. Rained gently last night, just enough to wash the town clean. And then today, a clean, crisp, fat spring day, the air redolent, the kind of green, minty, succulent air you'd bottle if you could, and snort greedily on bleak, wet January evenings when the streetlights hissed on at 4 in the afternoon, and all existence seems hopeless and sad. Daniel watches his grandmother's hair stream behind her, and he sees the brown fish leaping in the swirling silver river.
How'd you meet Grandpa?
We met by the river.
Did you love him right away?
No.
No?
I was fascinated, though.
Was he fascinated, too?
Yep.
How could you tell?
I could tell.
How?
I could tell. You'll see someday.
Was he in love?
He was fascinated.
Is that the same as love?
Oh, better.
Better than love?
There is no real love without fascination.
Is he still fascinated?
I sure hope so.
Are you?
Yes, indeedy.
Was Grandpa skinny then, too?
Skinny as a stick.
And funny like now?
Funny and kind like now.
What year was it when you met him?
Oh, a long time ago, Dano.
How old are you, Graham?
Old enough not to tell my impertinent grandson.
Why don't women say their ages?
Because people make assumptions.
How old is Grandpa?
Older than dirt.
How old is Cedar?
No one knows. Not even Cedar.
Really?
He doesn't know what year he was born, love, or where. Sometimes I think he is one of what your dad calls the Ancient Ones.
The Nishi, the fairies.
He doesn't say fairies, does he?
The Namaha, the good people, he says.
That's respectful. You're getting good with the Gaelic.
Dad's teaching me a little. It's cool.
The good people are always found near water, right? Like Cedar.
Cedar's small and fast, too, like them.
He is that.
Wasn't he ever married?
Not that I know of.
Was he married before you met him?
I don't know, love. I don't think so.
Didn't you ever ask about when he was a boy?
He doesn't remember, Daniel. He was nearly dead when your grandpa pulled him out of the river, and being in the water that long can hurt your brain.
It didn't hurt his, did it?
No. It did drown his memory, though.
I think he's really smart.
He's a great man in many ways.
If Grandpa died, would you marry Cedar?
Oh, your grandfather is too fascinated with this world to leave it, trust me.
But if he did die, would you marry Cedar?
I see you want Chapter 6 for homework also. Daniel grins and pedals off like a rocket, and Maplehead floats along through the fallen leaves, smiling, her eyes flashing with fish.
18. Owen, at work on the beaver, grins, remembering the afternoon he gave No Horses her first lesson in the Irish language. They met on the windy beach again, and walked hand in hand down to the cave at the south end, and sat there facing each other in the brilliant sand.
Okay, then, he says.
Okay, then, she says, smiling.
We'll start simple.
We'll start simple.
They grin.
I'll give you the Irish, and you repeat it.
Okay.
That way it will slip into you gently.
Okay.
Like music does.
Okay.
Not like school.
Enough already. Let's start.
Okay, then.
Okay.
Ta antranona gobra.
Ta an tranona go bra.
That means good afternoon.
Ta an tranona go bra.
Good. Now, kones ta tu.
Kones ta tu.
Good. That means, how are you?
Kones ta tu.
Good. Now, kin tanum ata ort?
Kin tanum ata ort?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.